Dr. Neeraj Kumar Sinha, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Singh, Dr. Selva Kumar, Dr. Sujit Mayan, Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari, Dr. Furhar Bali, Ms. Cheryl Banwarilal, Mr. Piyush Khandelwal, distinguished guests and online members, welcome to today's program, World Tourism Day. Since the year 1980, the United Nations World Tourism Organization has celebrated World Tourism Day as international observances on 27 September. This date was chosen as on that date in the year 1970, the statutes of the UNWTO were adopted. The adoption of those statutes is considered a milestone in global tourism. The purpose of this day is to raise awareness on the role of tourism within the international community and to demonstrate how its side effect, how it affects social, cultural, political, and economic values worldwide. The theme of the day was sustainable tourism in the year 2017. In 2018, the theme was tourism and digital transformation. And in 2019, the theme is tourism and jobs, a better future for all. Today, we welcome you for World Tourism Day with the theme being Hidden Gems of India. Without further ado, we would like to welcome our first guest speaker, and that is Dr. Neeraj Kumar Sinha. Sir is a superintending archaeologist at the Archaeological Survey of India, ASI. And so we'll be speaking on the hidden gem, Quarry Site of Ashoka, a stone pillar at Chunar. Welcome, Dr. Neeraj Kumar Sinha.
Thank you. Am I audible, madam?
Yes, sir, please speak.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. First of all, I would like to express my thanks and gratitude to Swami Vivekananda Cultural Center, Dublin, for giving me the opportunity to speak on the topic, Hidden Gem of India, on the occasion of World Tourism Day. My special thanks to Dr. Chaitanya Prakash Yogiji and other scholars of this organization, like Ms. Srishti Hariharan. I'm also curious to listen other distinguished scholar like Dr. Sanjeev Singh, my friend, Dr. Sal Kumar, Dr. Sujit Nayan, my younger brother, and my respected guru, Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari ji, and Dr. Fuhr Bali, and other scholars. On the auspicious occasion, with the grace of Goddess Saraswati, I would like to throw light on Quarry Site of Chunar in Mirzapur district of UP. Ever since the discovery of Ashokan pillar during British rule in India at Baisali, Ariraj, Rampurwa and Nandangarh in North Bihar, Sarnath, Prayagraj, Kausambi, Sankisa, Pralatpur in UP, Uttar Pradesh and at Delhi and Lumini in Nepal and the remains of 80 pillared hall at Pataliputra, geologists identified that these all pillars are carved out from the fine-grained sandstone of Chunar. The discovery of this site is like a revolution by the team of archaeologists led by late Professor P.C. Pant and Professor Vidula Jaiswal. The district of Chunar site is located in the Mirzapur district of UP, and Mirzapur lies in Varanasi division in the southeastern part of UP. Actually, it is form of alluvial plain of Ganga and Vindhyan range. It is just like flat top, like plateau type structure. The geology of this area can be divided into Ganga plain, Vindhyan tableland, and Kaimur hills and Son valley. The main rivers are Ganga and Son. The other seasonal rivers are Belan, Karmanasa, Rihan, Kamar, and Jargo etc. Now, I'm coming on the history. The great Emperor Ashoka ruled India from 272 to 232 BCE with its capital at Pataliputra. It is modern Patna. He was the grandson of founder of Mauryan dynasty, Mauryan empire, Chandragupta Maurya. His empire was extended from modern Afghanistan to Bangladesh and from Kashmir to entire Indian subcontinent in south, except Tamil Nadu and Kerala. The most important incident of his life was Kalinga War in 260 BCE. Ashoka won this war by killing of several thousand people of Kalinga. The killing of several thousand people in this war affected very adversely on the Ashoka heart. Ultimately, he converted himself into Buddhism. He waged out the desire of conquest and became the follower of Dhamma Vijaya. He became the priest of peace and generosity and appointed new officer to implement his new ideas toward the subject as he proclaimed, "All men are my children." His all royal decrees were engraved throughout his territory on stone boulders and stone pillars. These pillars are the edict were found standing or lying at Vaisali, Ariraj, Nandangarh and Rampurwa in Bihar, Sarnath, Allahabad, Kausambi in UP, at Firozshah Kotla in Delhi, and also at Sanchi in MP and Rumindehi and Nigliwa in Nepal. Each of them exhibit the characteristic of lustrous Mauryan polis. All these pillar height vary from 30 feet to 35 feet has a capital on its top depicting very finely carved animal like lion, bull and elephant on the decorated abacus. When Sang refer even some more pillars seen by him at Bodh Gaya, Rajgiri and Sravasti etc. Surprisingly, all these pillars are carved from Chunar sandstone quarry and transported through rivers and canals to the place where it is erected. The capital on the top of these pillars are masterpiece of Mauryan art. Even the 80-pillared hall of Pataliputra, exposed in course of archaeological excavation at Kumrar, is also transported from Chunar only. The loin capital is the of Sarnath is the noblest creation of Mauryan art and formed the nation crest in India of India. Sorry. It surmounted the inscribed Ashokan pillar and was originally crowned by Dharma Chakra, symbolizing the turning the wheel of law by Lord Buddha. Polish national emblem, the loin capital, which stands with its head high in aesthetic glory, its magnificence and unprecedented beauty, the excellence in the body of the four loins seated back to back on a circular abacus, their mannerism and feature of their face all leave one astonished. The artist's high expertise, devotion, and imagination became very apparent. The capital is about 2.31 meter in height and it is made of Chunar sandstone. An inverted lotus is carved at the bottom of this capital. There is a round abacus above the inverted lotus base. A horse, a lion, a bull, and elephant are carved on the abacus. A wheel with 24 spokes is carved in between the each pair of the animal. It is highly polished. Apart from pillar's capital, a few other specimens of Mauryan period were also discovered, which are also a masterpiece expression of artist, as the physical features are most beautiful and proportionate. They are Yakshi figure found from Didarganj and fragmentary sculpture of Jain image recovered from Lohanipur of Patna. Both sculptures have usual lustrous polish and physical structure. Yakshi figure reminds us the physical description in Kama Sutra. Now these two objects are displayed in the Patna Museum. In nutshell, it can be said that Chunar sandstone quarry played a very important role in the Indian history. Not only the pillar capital, but the inscription engraved on the surface of these pillars are a great source of study in ancient history. Ancient quarry in the hills around the Chunar township were identified in 1990 by Professor P.C. Pant and Professor Vidula Jaiswal. The hilltop of Chunar is littered with a number of cylindrical blocks of sandstone and are scattered randomly on the plateau-like flat terrain. In and around the dug rock formation and slope of hills, these large blocks were found lying in the depression of Nala and submerged in the Ganga. A detailed investigation conducted around the Bargaon village, which is in the Chunar, indicated that there were a number of undressed, half-dressed blocks and the heap of chiseled debris around the formation of limestone stone bed. On account of appearance, local folktale, the discovery of epigraph, it was possible to identify these abandoned quarry. As many as 452 ancient quarry containing mark of extraction of stone blocks, chiseling debris, undressed, half dressed, completely dressed, cylindrical block, and records of the blocks in the form of count mark were recorded by Professor Pant and a total number of 1,128 cylindrical blocks were noted, out of which 112 dressed blocks were also inscribed and reported by Professor Pant at Jaiswal, bearing inscription dating back to 3rd century BCE to 13th-14th century CE. These blocks are found lying inside at the other periphery of the quarry slope and in the valley in the cluster. The paleography of this inscribed block suggests that sandstone was being quarried from the hill of Chunar from Mauryan times to medieval period. The practice of exploiting these hills for raw material continued in the Middle Ganga Valley throughout the historical and modern period. There are some mason marks also on the pillars remains, and it was deciphered by Professor Ajay Mitra Shastri also. Now I am highlighting the how to develop this site from tourist point of view. Number one, the unfinished pieces of pillar shaft will be arranged and displayed properly as it is done in the open air museum. Secondly, the construction of an interpretation center. The aesthetically designed interpretation center will be constructed, in which the process followed by the ancient sculptors will shown through the electronic medium. Still photography of all the Mauryan and Gupta pillar, which were carved from Chunar stone quarry, will also be displayed. The close-up view of all the pillar capital, including other masterpieces of Mauryan art carved from Chunar quarry, will also be displayed. Various stages of carving of the pillar shaft and its capital will also be shown through the animation or other understandable medium. Number three, cultural notice board in various languages giving the brief history of the site on aesthetically designed board will also be provided. QR code should also be displayed at the site, which will enable with maximum information about the site. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. I am thankful to the Swami Vivekanand Cultural Center, Dharwad. Once again, thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Neeraj Kumar Sinha, for sharing some light on the hidden gem quarry site of Ashoka, the stone pillar at. Our next guest speaker joining us from India is Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Singh. Sir is an archaeologist and museologist in India. His topic on his hidden gem, he will be speaking on Vikram Shila in Bihar. Welcome, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Singh.
Namaskar. It is an opportunity to first of all thank the organizer, Yogi ji, and Shastri, and all other members at Durban of the Vivekanand Cultural Center. The opportunity when we are celebrating this day, the topic is such a fantastic, the hidden gems of the India. And you know why I have chosen the topic Vikram Shila to as a hidden gem of the India. Vikram Shila, when we talk about the ancient university, the name of we have the Takshila, we have the Nalanda, then third name comes in our mind is a Vikram Shila. And Vikram Shila is such a magnificent university that attracted the students around the globe at that time. And the establishment, before this establishment of the university, the place was known for the beautiful their architecture, stone rock art, and the panoramic view of natural. Here Ganga flows, it is, first of all I'll introduce, Vikramsila is situated in Bhagalpur district of Bihar, near Kahalgaon, and the Uttar, it is on the bank of the Uttarvahini, north flowing Ganga, and the panoramic view is such magnificent, one can see and mesmerize with the beauty of that place. That is a real gem, natural gem as well as the archaeological gem. So that is why Vikramsila has been chosen by Dharmapal, who was one of the founder of the Pal dynasty in 8th-9th century. They have chosen because it has a panoramic view in the pocket. It is in the basin of the small hillocks, and in the right the Ganga river was flowing, and the otherwise it is surrounded by the small hillock or mountain. So so that is the place was itself is magnificent, and the when the Pala ruler Dharmapal has chosen this place, it is nearer to Nalanda also, only 200 from Nalanda towards the east. So this Vikramsila is known for a better place and a hidden gem of for the point of the tourism. It has a history, it has an archaeology, it has a natural phenomenon, and also for the those who are having the riverine tourism, they have the dolphins. Only Gangetic dolphins are here only. Gangetic dolphins are found here only in the Bhagalpur district, and the main center is the Vikramsila, which was earlier known as Antichak or Bateshwar Sthan or Patharghatta. And the before that it has a beautiful panel of Matri Devi carved in the stone of the Gupta period. So you have the continuity, and the prior to that we have the Paleolithic tools also in this area. So it has the continuation. You have the Paleolithic, you have the early history, then you have the history, and you are going up on the modern history too. That is why it is very important. The Vikramsila, the place Vikramsila is very important because of this university, a magnificent university set by the Dharmapal. Pala rule. Here the important where the tantrism was taught, and the it was tantrism was taught in all the aspects. Here all the aspects where of the education was taught by the known and that time's renowned worldwide Buddhist teachers. So they were teaching the philosophy, teaching the economy, they are teaching the medicines, and obviously tantrism is one of the focal point. And Lama Taranath has given its vivid description. Lama Taranath was a Tibetan monk, visited here. He has recorded everything here. He has given a beautiful description about that. And he has mentioned about one teacher known Atis Dipankar. Atis Dipankar was known as the one of the best teacher in the world, Buddhist teacher, and he was the worshipped in Lama Tibetan in Tibet and other places as a god. He is shown as the incarnation of Lord Buddha itself. So that is the fascinating, magnificent place. Magnificent archaeological remains was really a gem for the tourist destination, and still the destination is there. Tourists are flowing, but they are the local tourists. We don't have the much more international tourists. Now it is internationally known. When the exhibition was conducted in by the Patna University, and subsequently by the Archaeological Survey of India in 70s, that the importance they discovered, they in the exhibition they found the huge monastery and the stupa, huge monastery, and they it has a four door, a four gateway, and the four the students were getting admission where the after discussing and they are interviewed by the acharyas, those who are sitting in the different four gates, and these four gates are for the four stream of the knowledge, philosophy for example, religion for example. So they are sitting, the acharyas were sitting in the different gateway, and the student has to get the interview, and those who are qualifying they are getting the entry in the monastery, that is a university. So that is a that was also exposed by the Archaeological Survey of India exhibition, and the Patna University ancient Indian History Archaeology Department exposed it, and it is known to the world. So we have the chamber of the monastery, we have the hostels, that is monastery, we have the chamber of the tantras, sadhana kendras. So these every aspect of Buddhist life can be seen there, that is visible after the exhibition, that is visible. So that is why Vikramsila is to be known as the hidden gem. Now it is exposed to the world, but still it is a hidden gem. Every year we are at least 1.2 million people are coming there for religious conglomeration. Every Maghi Purnima, the Hindu month of the Magh, and Kartik Purnima, the people from the Nepal, Assam, Bengal, of course Bihar is also obviously there, so they are coming here because it is a Uttar Vahini Ganga, north flowing Ganga is there. So people are coming here, they are taking the holy bath here, so that they with a belief that their pap will be, the sin will be washed out. Such a magnificent and wonderful place. If you go there, if anybody go there, they will mesmerize with the natural beauty and the archaeological remains. That is why but unfortunately, as it happened in the early medieval period, it was destroyed by invader Bakhtiar Khilji. He has completely ruined, as he has ruined the Nalanda University, he also ruined this university too. And it was a phonetic and the religious intolerance can be seen over there. But despite all that, despite this destruction, the archaeological remains are still saying, it's narrating itself that it is the place where when one can enjoy, when one can feel proud of their glory. That was the university as a learning center of the Buddhist art. So this is with this background, I feel that Vikramsila to be looked into in different perspective. And also I will tell you that why it is also important. It is situated, it is beautifully connected with the railway, it is beautifully connected with the roadway from Patna to Calcutta, in the way of the Patna to Calcutta, and the riverine way is also there, which is mentioned as a Uttarapath, and the riverine way, Nadi Marg, those who are going to Tamralipti is also flowing beside it. So that it has the historicity, it has the historiographical records, and it has the narrations. So that is why it should be there. Also, one point also I will add in it. That is, it is declared by the government of India to be part of the Buddhist circle in 2012. It was declared by the government of India, it will be a part of this. But it is also important for the Tantric studies. So we have the Vikramsila, we have the from here to 230 kilometers, we have the Tarapit, that is in Bengal, and also we have the Devghar, it is in Jharkhand now, where the Jyotirling, Dwadas Jyotirling is there. So if that is also triangle, and the Bihar government that time Bihar and Jharkhand was one state, so Bihar government has planned that as a triangle of the tantric movement. So so it has an importance, Buddhist circuit, tantric circuit, as well as a natural and riverine archaeology over there. So that is why I feel that archaeological remains of the Buddhist university, which is known not only in India globally, because the students were minimum number of the students from India was admitted, maximum number of the students from the world was admitted in this university. That is why this university is very important, and we have the remains. That is why we say that it is a hidden gem of the Indian tourism, and it should be developed with that. Thanks. With this note, I would like to thanks all organizer, and particularly Shastri ji, to whom I pay my best of respect. And also in the panel, I have the one of my favorite teacher, Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari, and my dearest friend, Langotia Yar Neeraj Kumar Sinha, my younger brother Sujit Nayan, and my student Parwali is there. So I am thankful to all, and I believe that all of us will promote this place as one of the tourist center, because it is a living tourist center, and we have to promote it in better prospects and better way. Thank you very much. Dhanyavaad. Aap logon ka sabhi ka dhanyavaad.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kumar Singh, for shedding light on the Vikramshila in Bihar. We definitely learned that the Gangatic dolphins are visible there. Our next guest speaker is Dr. Salva Kumar. Dr. Salva Kumar is an associate professor at the Tamil University, Tanjore. So, the hidden gem of the Kazhugu Malai in Southern Tamil Nadu. We would like to now welcome Dr. Salva Kumar.
Okay. Yeah, good afternoon, all of you. I am very glad to be here as part of this Vivekananda Cultural Center, Indian Embassy at Durban's program for the World Tourism Day, and focusing on the hidden gems of tourism. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. C.P. Yogi and Sri Hari Narayan, and Nandan Tiwari, Neeraj Kumar Sinha, Sanjeev Kumar, Fugar Bali, and other speakers here. So I am going to speak on the site of Kazhugu Malai, which is located in the southern part of Tamil Nadu. It is a very important tourist center. But it has not been focused much. It is famous for several architectural remains, mainly a monolithic cave temple and also other Jain images. So I have a PowerPoint presentation. I hope I can share and present this my screen. With this PowerPoint, I'll explain this particular site. Yeah. I hope you can see my PowerPoint here. So from the beginning. So my topic is on architectural marvels of Kazhugu Malai in southern Tamil Nadu, India. And this place is located in the extreme south of Tamil Nadu. And India is very rich in cultural heritage, as we all know. It has diverse cultural tradition and a rich variety of monuments and both tangible and intangible heritage, which we need to promote much more intensively. Currently, we have selected certain few sites and we are promoting. In fact, by focusing on the monuments in the remote areas, we can really contribute to economic development and welfare of the people. The site I have selected today is Kazhugu Malai. If we look into the southern Tamil Nadu, we have several important archaeological sites and cultural centers like Madurai. Madurai was a center of the Pandyas for more than 2,500 years, and it has a famous Meenakshi temple. And then we have a Kiredi archaeological site where the Tamil Nadu government is planning to create a museum. And then further east, if we go on the east coast, we have Rameshwaram Island. This Kazhugu Malai is about 122 kilometers south of Madurai, which has the airport. It is close to National Highway 44. And it is in Thoothukudi district of Kovilpattu Taluk. And it is 59 kilometers north of Tirunelveli. In the medieval inscription, this site was known as Perunechuram and Aranechuram as the names. Now you can see in this particular map, Madurai is located here. The site of Kazhugumalai is here, Sivakasi, which is famous for craters, and then you have Rameshwaram here and Kanyakumari here, and this particular site, and Tirunelveli is another famous site, which is famous for temples, and we have another Iron Age site called Adichanallur, where the central government is planning to build a museum, and we have another site here, Tiruchendur, which is famous for Murugan temple. So the site is very conveniently located in the circuit, but only thing is we need to create certain infrastructure here at this site so that it can become a huge attraction. Malai in Tamil means hill. This Kazhugumalai, the main attraction is a huge hill. These hills have been center of occupation right from the early time. Wherever there were hills, the kings were creating either rock temples or rock structures or other architectural features, and they remain even to this day. These granite hillocks were main attraction in South India because these hillocks provided good water source even in the dry region. What happens when there is heavy rain? These hills trap the rainwater and release it gradually for over 2-3 months. As a result of this, people preferred these locations for their settlement. And this is the Kazhugumalai. Malai is the Malai means actually hill. Kazhugu is actually eagle or vulture, or it could it is one kind of bird, and it is also considered, another version is considered as Garuda and sacred. And Kazhugumalai, we have three important segments of tourist attraction. First is rocket monolithic temple datable to 8th century. It is known as Vettuvan Koil. We have Jain sculptures and cave temple, a cave temple of again 8th, 9th century of early Pandyas, and it is dedicated to Subramanya. This is the temple of Vettuvan Koil. It is partly completed, partly unfinished. But if you look at this particular structure, it has a beautiful Ekatala Dravida Vimana with a beautiful Dravida style octagonal Shikara, and this Kapota, and also these Kudu features with beautiful human figures. And you have all these Karnakuta and Kuda and Sala kind of figures. Architectural members in between. In between, you also have beautiful sculptures of Shiva, various forms of Shiva, and also Vishnu and Brahma. This is actually scooped out of the granite hill. This is comparable to the Kailasha temple at Ellora. While people know Kailasha temple at Ellora, this particular gem is really hidden in the granite hillock. If you look at it, you can see the marvelous architectural features, and it has exquisite carvings and floral motifs which are really attractive. It has various beautiful sculptures, various forms of Shiva as Uma Maheshwara and Dakshinamurti and Vishnu and Brahma. This is another view of this particular monolithic rock. It is complete only up to the Kapata level. At the bottom portion, it is incomplete, whereas on the interior, the shells have been complete. This is the view from the front area. You can look at this particular monolithic temple being very attractive. Here you can see Shiva and also various architectural features and the Ganas carrying this particular shala and this particular structures and the Shikara here. This is a very beautiful motif, and it is very interestingly carved with minute working. Unfortunately, it has not been complete. Another important structure here is Muruga Subramanya Shrine, which is a cave temple that is located further in the lower part of the hill. There is a story connecting this particular particular monolith, and it is said there was a feud between father and son, and they were fighting over the completion of their temples, and finally it was the son who succeeded, and this particular story is attributed to Shiva and Shiva's son Subramanya. If you look at the Subramanya shrine, which is known as Kalkachaleshwarar at the lower hill, that is complete, whereas this particular one is incomplete. But again, I think we should see this as a kind of myth. And this Kazhugachalamurthy cave temple is located at the base of the hill. In the front area, they have built a later mandapa with a lot of architectural features that is datable to Vijayanagara or Nayaka period. And if you go interior, you can see the original Pandya period cave temple. These cave temples were predominant features in the southern part of India, mainly during the time of Pallavas and Pandyas. They introduced these cave architecture, they built cave temples, and also they also constructed monolithic temples. If you can look at these pothikas and pillars, this is the original structure datable to 8th, 9th century. What you see in the front is the later additions. You have this particular temple beautifully documented by Archaeological Survey of India by Dayalan. He has published three volumes of this particular cave temples and several other temples in southern Tamil Nadu. You have a Mukhamandapa and Ardhamandapa and the shrine behind. And this is a section view of this particular shrine. In the main shrine, you have Subramanya with Valli and Devasena. And Subramanya is seated here on a peacock. This is a very interesting sculpture here. And apart from that, the second rocket cave temple, we also have Jaina Deepthangara images, several Jain sculptures. And here you see Parswanatha flanked by Aksha, and several other Tirthangaras are also carved here. We have Vattezhuthu or cursive character inscriptions found at this site. They refer to Araimalai Alvar as the deity or of the presiding deity or sacred images here. The images were contributed by various followers of Jainism. Kazhugumalai was also a center of various Jain saint. Kunasagara Bhattara was a Jain ascetic who lived here. And this particular sculptures, they are datable to the time of Parantak and Nedunchandayan in the 8th century. And the Jain activities were continuing till 13th century. If you look at the architectural temples features in Tamil Nadu, you see a lot of this Brahminical Shaivite and Vaishnavite temples after the beginning of the Bhakti movement. In the period before the Bhakti movement was dominated by Buddhism and Jainism, after the beginning of the Bhakti movement and the development of state formation under the Pallavas and Pandyas, you have lot of these cave temples built all across. Whereas in some pockets, Jainism also existed in certain areas for which we have several evidence. We get a lot of Jain sculpture. The hill itself is a huge attraction. If you climb on top the hill, you can have a very picturesque surrounding. We have, especially during the rainy season, you see a lot of cultivated fields. And right now, these monuments are protected by Tamil Nadu State Archaeology Department. And in fact, we can do a lot of things for promote. You look at the map here, this particular temple is located away from the highway. I didn't show the highway here. This is the main highway, NH44, connecting Madurai to Tirunelveli. This is located a little off, about 10 kilometer west. In fact, if we really develop a site museum and promote some kind of activities, it can be a real contribution to local development. And we need to think of these kind of secondary centers in India where we can contribute, as pointed out by Sanjeev Kumar Singh in the case of Vikramashila. We have already developed world heritage. We have several world heritage sites like Tanjavur Bragadishwara Temple and Ajanta and Ellora. These are one class of monuments. Right now in our tourism planning, we need to focus on these second tier cities or third tier cities where we have a lot of heritage remains. They are not properly cared for. We need if actually good investment in developing these centers in such a way that can generate employment and also contribute to tourism. When we talk of tourism, we should not only think of foreign exchange or foreign currency, we should also focus on heritage education. How are we going to teach the cultural heritage of our rich cultural heritage and the pluralistic ways of life that you see at many sites? Like here, we have Jainism and Saivism flourishing side by side. So we have several such sites which can really contribute to in developing tourism and also contribute to the local economy. That is why I chose this particular site of Kazhugumalai as an important architectural marvel, architectural gem that has many lessons to offer that can also contribute to the understanding of the local people as well as heritage tourism. With this few points, I would like to thank the organizers, Vivekananda Cultural Center at Durban, for giving me the opportunity. And also, I would like to thank the fellow panelists for highlighting such important gems and their importance in heritage tourism. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Sir, and sharing light on the beauties of Southern Tamil Nadu. Our next guest speaker is Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari. Sir is from the Department of History and Art in Banaras, India. And so we'll be speaking on the hidden gem of Deoghar. We would now like to welcome Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari.
So do you expect me to say? Am I audible? Okay. Deoghar Cultural Center of Durban in South Africa for inviting me to speak, and also thanks to all the participants. We are celebrating, or we are going to celebrate, we are speaking on the occasion of International Tourism Day. And I will be speaking on Deoghar. It's an important site, Indian site of heritage culture. Before that, I would like to say within 2-3 minutes what exactly tourism means to all of us. So, tourism is a means to get into the spirit and also to the end. And the end is the realization, end is the understanding, the end is the social religious harmony, and end is to acquire knowledge, thereby develop our social harmony, in the spirit of what has been said in Indian tradition, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. We can achieve this, for which the best way will be to promote tourism and through tourism. Because tourism means interaction, interactive human activity. It was a very, very natural, primable, basic human activity everywhere in the world. And now we say that the world or the has become a village. And this concept was very much in Indian tradition long back. And the tradition was also so much that for mundan, for marriage, for social purposes, for environment, we were traveling from one place to Rameshwaram, then Kanyakumari to Kashmir. So this inherited text. Another thing is, what is life? Life is movement. No movement, being static, means dead. Life means if movement is there, then we are alive. Again, in the spirit, we find Upanishad says, Charaiveti, Charaiveti, Charaiveti. Keep on moving, keep on moving, keep on moving. What is moving? Traveling, touring. And through tour, through travel, we learn so much that we can't learn by way of reading book, hundreds of pages. We can learn only by way of undertaking one tour, one travel to 2-3 places. You got social, human interactions at different levels. Now, to obtain peace, global peace, human peace, individual peace, and every year on World Tourism Day, WTO gives a slogan. Back, a slogan came that tourism is a tool or key to world peace. Very important. So there is a purpose. Now coming to Devgarh. Devgarh is very little known, lesser attended by the scholars, and very few tourists go to that place. Mainly they are the pilgrims, Jain pilgrims, take that place to be a Jain tir. But what is important and what is should be told, and then it becomes the hidden gems of India in terms of tourism, that it is perhaps the unique and to my knowledge the only where we find the heritage act human activity for the longest period, and that even in continuity for 5,000 years. From prehistoric times, about 3000 BCE to 1700 CE. So it becomes a unique site where one can just get into the heritage assessment or could know about the heritage. Second, that it has been a composite site of composite heritage where we can show here proof, evidence is there where we find that the Hindu religion, the best and most finished period, Vaishnav temple dedicated to Vishnu. Dashavatara, full sculpture, excellent Nar Narayan form, Shai Vishnu, this is just unparalleled. So one can find even the rendering of Ganga Yamuna on the doorways of the temples. It starts in a complete form from that temple. So that is there, as well as the Buddhist rock cut sculptures are there in the caves. And of course, it was a very prolific center of Jain art. So Vaishnavism here, Shaiv sculpture, the Shakti sculpture. So it is a unique in the sense that not only in terms of its long continuous history giving, as well as the socio-religious harmony and becoming a composite site which could be the best for visiting, for presenting, for the tourist department, for tourism. Another point is that there we have everything, not only the history, prehistory, material evidence, but as well as the Silva background is there, the natural surrounding is there, the Betwa river flows just wonderfully. The caves are there, the rocks are there, and as well as the temples and sculptures also are there. And they outnumber any of the other Jain sites, unparalleled Jain sites. So the two, because of two important dimensions, along with a place to live at because of the natural Silva background surrounding, all that what we need for enjoying the nature, that is there. It happens to be one of the unique sites in India, but unfortunately is not yet in the tourist map, and hardly apart from the pilgrims coming for the Jain pilgrimage, we hardly find in one day 10 to 20 tourists because of its situation and lacking in some material facilities like road, proper accommodation. One has to either live in Dharmashala or will go back to Lalitpur, 37 kilometers away. So there should be a proper accommodation, good accommodations, hotels should be there, and the promotional efforts should be taken up if we really want to promote tourism on the occasion of World Day. It's an inspirational site, not only to look at the images, not only to look at them for worshipping them, because they are worthy of adoration. Jain Tirthankaras are there, the Yakshis are there, the goddess of learning Saraswati is there. But beyond that, aesthetics elements are there of the Brahminical, Buddhist, Jain, all inspirational. And that is very important. And the inspiration of the spiritual attainment by way of worshipping the Jain Tirthankaras, we acknowledge and we just observe that we should take the path of non-acquisition renunciation, aparigrah tyag, through looking at those Vitaragi Tirthankar images or looking at those temples. So they become source of inspiration for the tourist as well. Apart from enjoying the stay, apart from nature and the surrounding, apart from just catering the religious need or religious faith, he gets an inspiration as well. And that is another important, and another point is, here we have more than 25 Jain temples ranging in date from 8th to 17th century, the longest Jain site in terms of history. And that is very important. So that way, it was a workshop site. One should be surprised to see that without having any direct royal patronage, in such magnitude, in enormous way, in thousands of sculptures, how could they be carved? How such beautiful temples and sculptures like Dashavatar and the Jain temples and rock cut could be carved out? It was the collective effort, more of the masses' contribution, done more by the masses. This is to be shown, this is to be understood, as well as the Jain Acharya, the prophets, they were contributing. That was the place of Saraswat Sadhana, the great learning. Because nowhere else in India we find in such good number the figures of the Acharyas, just teaching the disciples, the teaching the ascetics and all that. And therefore, to my mind, I think also a package should be made, some development in terms of material facilities should be undertaken so as to attract the people for coming to Devgarh to visit not only the Dashavatar temple, Buddhist caves, even Buddhism. The people coming from Buddhism, they are also have point of interest for them. And the Jains, of course, remain important place, as well as in the radius of about 30 to 40 kilometers, we have a 4, 5, 6 cluster of sites, other sites, with natural beauty, natural surrounding. So an entire package could be made, and that would cover Devgarh, Chandpur, Chandheri, Siron, Sironpur. Chandheri is famous for its sari. So that way, I think Devgarh is important place, heritage site, cultural site, and of composite nature of such long history and culture, and also a beautiful nature, so that it has to offer so many things to the visitors that one should visit, and the site should be promoted and a package should be made. With this, I thank everybody, every participant, my friends, and I'm happy that I could say something and I got the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Professor Maruti Antiwati, for enlightening us on Deoghar. Our next guest speaker is Dr. Fuhar Bali. Ma'am is the alumni of the Institute of Archaeology in New Delhi, and she'll be speaking on the hidden gems, lesser known temples in Jammu Kashmir. We'd now like to Dr. Fuhar Bali.
Namaskar. I'm thankful to Swami Vivekananda Cultural Center Durban for considering me for a brief talk on World Tourism Day. Today, I'm going to speak on the topic of lesser known temples of Jammu region. But before going on further, I just want to tell you something about the role of religion and region. Elemental to human eudaimonia since inceptions have been the concepts of spirituality. These transcendental concepts in the course evolved into Jammu region, located in the northernmost part of India, is a perfect amalgamation of natural and man-made sacred spaces. It has impeccable pristine natural landscape and that is revered in sacred literature, and tangible spiritual aura radiated by its temples. It is a well-known fact that pilgrimage to holy shrine of Mata Vaishno Devi Ji temple at Katra, Jammu, is one of the top religious destination in India. However, there are other architectural worthy temple structures that are need to be appreciated. Many of the these lesser known temple structures show the unique confluence of Pahari and Kalinga architectural style. It is thus pertinent to explore the diversity of temple structures and outline roadmap of tourism in that region. But before going on further, I just want to show you the newly created map of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. On the recommendation of Parliament, the President of India effectively dismantled Article 370 of Indian Constitution and gave consent to Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act 2019. Now, out of a single state, Jammu and Kashmir, there are two new Union Territories of India, Union Territories of J&K and Union Territory of Ladakh. Apart from these two main districts, I'm going to talk about the Jammu region in particular. And as we are running short of time, so I'm considering only the Udhampur district of that region. There are basically 10 districts of Jammu region, and in this Udhampur region, we have a number of temple heritage structures that are still unknown to the world that usually came there as a pilgrimage. Architecture in this area consists of two kind of sacred spaces. There are natural sacred spaces and man-made sacred spaces. The natural sacred spaces are in the form of pindis, etc., whereas the man-made sacred spaces are in the form of temples, baolis, ghats, rock carvings, etc. I'm considering first is a Krimchi group of temples in this area. This is situated on a hillock locked in two rivulets, Birhama and Krimchi, at a distance of 12 km north of Udhampur Lander Road. The group of temples are locally known as Pandava temples. The complex consists of five temples and two small shrines. The temple on plan consists of a garbhagriha and kavinir shikhara, an elongated antaral with a shuknasika on it. Some of the temples have a pillared mandapa in front of antaral also. In It is the most developed and elaborately ornamented temple of this particular group complex. It depicts large moldings, niches for Saptamatrikas in addition to Parshvadevtas also. This it is followed by in this temple number one. It is elaborate on plan and is higher in elevation. Its mandapa is entered through a prefoliate arches. It is presumed that it had roof in pyramidical shape. This is temple number three. This is actually there are remains of the temple number three are still remain. This is temple number four also. It is totally in a broken condition. This is said that this temple marks the beginning of developed temple architecture at Krimchi. It shows niches for Parshvadevtas and designs on the antaral. Chance discovery shows that it has a brick structure temple. It is built on a high raised platform. This is temple number six. This is also a developed temple structure made up out of stones. This temple is the most is said that it is the most earliest kind of temple structure belongs to this particular group complex. This is a general photograph of Krimchi group of temples. This is Nand Babur temple. It is dedicated to Lord Shiva. It is built on high platform. It has three sanctums, each predated in an antaral attached to common mandapa. The jams of antaral and sanctum are covered with figures of Ganga, Yamuna, Shiva, Parvati. This is Devi Bhagwati temple in this area. The temple is built in Saptaratha in plan. Externally, it consists of Garbhriha and Antaral with its square mandapa. The mandapa is entered through its western wall. The latter had flight of steps both inside and outside. The shikhara is missing and mandapa is left with us. It has some sculptures of Devi Bhagwati, Ganesha and Parshvadevtas also. We have Ganga and Yamuna sculptures at the dojang. This is Dera temple. It is built on high platform. It is approached by a flight of steps on the west side. It has two principal sanctums divided from each other by octane wall. Each of these sanctum is preceded by a porch having two floated pillars. This is temple number one of Kala Dera temple. Only it is built on high platform and it is preceded by a mandapa. The entrance is in a flight of steps towards the east. Saptaratha in plan. There is one sculpture of dancing Shiva we found from this particular area. It has a Makarmukh pranal also. I want to sum up the works of Professor Himanshu Prabhare ma'am, that the study of religion or dharma can be has been dominated by either by the textual analysis, iconographic studies, or examination of religious practices such as pilgrimage, the potential of archaeology has been grossly underutilized. So it can contribute quite meaningful notions to it, but identify this area, say that it has, it can be developed as a center of rural tourism, and sustainable tourism can be developed in this area. Thank you very much.
In Jammu and Kashmir. On behalf of the Cultural Center, on today being World Tourism Day, I would like to request you all on your next trip to India or your next visit to India to kindly visit all these beautiful hidden gems. We've come to the concluding part of today's program. We now welcome Ms. Cheryl Banwarilal to render vote of thanks. Welcome, Cheryl ji.
On behalf of the Swami Vivekananda Cultural Center, the Consulate General of India in Durban, it gives me great pleasure to express our deep gratitude and say a huge thank you to Dr. Niraj Kumar Sinha. I would like to express our deep gratitude and appreciation to Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Singh. I would like to express our deep gratitude and say thank you to Dr. Salva Kumar. I would like to express our deep gratitude and say a huge thank you to Professor Maruti Nardan Tiwari. I would like to express our deep gratitude and appreciation to Dr. Puhar Bali. I would like to thank Dr. Chaitanya Prakash Yogi, the director of the Swami Vivekananda Cultural Center. I would like to thank Ms. Shasti Harinarayan for always being our lovely MC. I would like to thank Mr. Piyush Khandewal for all the technical support and making our online programs a success. Please continue watching our online programs. Stay home and stay safe. Thank you.